Matt, hur är läget?
Det är jättebra. Tack så mycket att du har med mig idag.
Det är otroligt kul att ha dig i Stockholm.
Ja, det är gott att vara här.
Okay, Matt, you need to take us back. How did you end up learning Swedish? Potentially the world's most useful language.
I mean, I lived here 20 years ago and for 2 years and, you know, had the opportunity to study and get to know a lot of people and really enjoyed being here and wanted to learn Swedish. So jag tog jag hade tillfälle att lära mig lite svenska, så jag gjorde det.
It must feel very full circle to me.
Yeah. Så det är gott att vara tillbaka i Sverige. Det trivs mycket bra i Sverige. Jag kommer här så ofta som jag kan med min familj. Och tack så mycket att du har mig idag.
Yeah, I was speaking to some folks in the Sequoia team, and they said you take any opportunity to come to Stockholm.
Yeah,
so
I
you
do.
Were very quick to reply.
Yeah, I was just like, yep, I'm in. But the funny story is so once, you know, several years ago, when my Swedish was even more fresh and not as rusty as it is now, I got invited to go to Klarna, which is one of our investments, and talk about what was happening in the wave of microservices, which is another, you know, interesting technology innovation at the time. And I started out my speech in Swedish, and I got all these blank stares. I was like, oh no, my Swedish has gotten so bad. But what it was is that half the engineering team didn't speak Swedish.
Exactly.
and moved into Stockholm and been imported. So I guess it's, you know, Stockholm's really advanced since I lived here 20 years ago and become far more international now. But
100%. Yeah, it's probably even less useful now than yeah. before. I wanted to start, you know, I remember at the early days of Sana, I read this, like, elements of enduring companies. Like, if you want to build a truly enduring company, you have a set of principles to do that. And I think it's particularly fascinating now with AI, how this may be shifting.
Yeah.
Do you feel like you want to update those, or do they hold as true today as ever before? And how would you say the different principles sort of apply to building an AI company?
I mean, I think that the fascinating thing is that with every wave of new technology, the rules get rewritten a little bit. And then a new set of opportunity to go do all of the cool things is created again for another set of founders and entrepreneurs. But still, some of these core concepts, I think, remain the same. And particularly in the AI wave, I think it's about the one that we really focus a lot on is the sustainable competitive advantage.
Yeah.
And because with generative AI and the birth of LLMs, there's a lot of opportunities to leverage some of these open models and build businesses that can grow incredibly rapidly.
Yeah.
But then you got to think about, well, if I'm benefiting from this other technology that's universally available to everybody, it's like I'm one of the first people to use the cloud. Imagine what that was like, right? You got a really quick run up, really nice revenues from the beginning, but when lots of people figure out how to use the cloud, your advantages may change.
Yeah.
And so it's about thinking, you got to think several steps ahead of there's going to be a first mover's advantage for many companies, and that's absolutely worth seizing. But then the next step is how do you create something that's sustainable, that locks in the customers, that endures as you think about how to build the value proposition for your business. So I think that's probably the most important one, but it evolves a little bit with this wave because now we have these great technologies available to help fuel new businesses and new business ideas.
And how do you build that sustainable competitive advantage?
I mean, it's different for every company, right? So, I think if you're thinking about building something on top of a third-party LLM structure, you need to think about what are the workflows, what are the services, what are the things that your customers will value. I think that there's a whole other vein that we talk about of, you know, we call the picks and shovels, the companies that enable the infrastructure for people to use these technologies themselves. That tends to be an area where people can usually build things that are very differentiated, that are specific to their customers. It's just thinking about what will continue to keep a customer with you and what are the things you can build to give yourself a lead over others who will come into the space, because everybody is trying to come into the space.
And if you were to, like, write the case study of one example of these companies, like, which company would you pick?
That
except for Sana.
In what way? In what way? That we did something right, or that did something
that did this right?
Yeah, there's a lot of companies that are built. I mean, the OpenAI story is an obvious one of massive sustainable competitive advantage. But even, like, look at smaller companies like Character.
Yeah.
Like, who imagined that these chatbots were going to become so popular and people were going to want to interact with them in such a regular cadence in this world where social media has become just scrolling and looking at the next TikTok, to all of a sudden we've got millions of people like interacting regularly and chatting messages back and forth with these AI bots. Like, that's a really interesting competitive advantage. They've built the infrastructure themselves. They've built the background models themselves. They've managed the customer experience. They have a great competitive advantage versus any competitors that may come because their users are fairly engaged and locked in.
Yeah, I think OpenAI is such an interesting example because you're an investor in OpenAI. And how do you think about market sizing? You know, it's already the valuation is already at sort of 30 billion or so. And how do you think about the market sizing for a company like that?
I mean, I think it's not crazy to think that building the company that creates many of the most powerful generative AI models that fuel the world is a $1 trillion market cap opportunity. We're already in the age of $1 trillion market cap tech companies.
Yeah.
You know, it's AWS in a standalone basis is close to a $1 trillion market cap opportunity. And so it's not crazy to see how OpenAI has that same potential. Now, OpenAI is trying to figure out specifically their relationship they want to have between doing good and building a business, which is a tricky way to navigate. And so we'll just have to see how that works itself out over time. But the potential that they have to change the world and to do really tremendous things is incredible. And we're just thrilled to be associated with them.
Yeah, and how do you think about another company that Nathan was talking about earlier today with NVIDIA that's just completely crushing it? And it feels like a company that has a lot of enduring moats that I wouldn't be the first one to compete with. However, you are actually competing with them through your investment.
I know. It's funny. It's actually with one of our own. So we were the seed investors in NVIDIA in 1992, and then led the Series A in NVIDIA, and worked with them for many years. And then I came along and cavalierly led an investment in an AI microchip company called Graphcore, which is based in the UK. And frankly, like, it's been hard for the independent AI chip companies. The moats that NVIDIA has are awesome, and they have a $7 billion a year R&D budget. And so if I was starting, having worked a little bit in the AI semiconductor space now, if I was looking to start an AI startup, I probably wouldn't start in chips. I'd probably start on the software layer because I think it's just going to be easier and there's more things to help you and advantage you. But, you know, like everything, there's new innovations happening because these workloads are different, they operate differently, and so we're looking at other semiconductor companies right now that help with better interconnection technology, help leverage, deal with that there's just a shortage of GPUs and help other companies' GPUs like Intel and AMD perform better. And so we're still looking and active in that space, but NVIDIA is really a monster, and they've really taken, I mean, just look at the last earnings call. I mean, it's really tremendous to see what they've done.
What do you think is the one thing that makes the NVIDIA so tough to compete with?
Jensen.
Yeah, we were thrilled to have Jensen here, and I definitely agree. That's the single sort of competitive advantage.
Yeah, I mean, the man's an animal. Like, he doesn't sell shares in his company. He lives in the house that his family grew up in, I think it's in Los Altos there in the suburbs of California. He's not like riched himself up, you know, like some of these other famous luminary tech CEOs. Yeah. He's just laser focused on winning.
Yeah.
And just crushes it day after day. He doesn't do one-on-ones.
Yeah.
He has lots of like unique management style things to really be focused on just delivering results. Only come talk to me if you're delivering results. Don't give me this, you know, no flowery check-ins in my company. And it's really tremendous. Like he also came to a summit that we had at Sequoia and spoke, and it was tremendous. And he is the driver of that company today. And it's a story of tremendous perseverance, right? Yeah. Because for a long time, it was just a graphics card company. And then all of a sudden the AI opportunity emerged, and they just directly barreled in and took it over.
Yeah, it's actually incredibly fascinating how Jensen leads the company. He has 40 direct reports. I was with him in the office, and we were going a bit, out of time. And he was like, no worries. I'm here until 12. And every single day he's there from 9 to 12 in the office. And they don't really do plans either, which is really fascinating. You know, you would expect like the world's fifth largest company to have like a 5-year plan or whatever.
Yep.
He thinks those are completely useless. So he just has the entire company send him the 5 top things every single week. And then he just reads a couple of hundred of those every single morning to make sure people are working on the right stuff.
It's crazy.
So it's interesting how his like operating model has become, you know, a competitive advantage there. I mean, you must effectively see every single sort of AI startup in, on the planet. Where would you wish founders would spend more time solving problems than they are today?
I think that, you know, we invested in this really interesting young company called Harvey recently, which is a it's led by my partner Pat Grady, that's basically using AI to augment the early law associate years with all of the work and processing with contracts and so on and so forth. And I think that verticalization of, we have labor shortages in every segment in every industry right now, and I'd love to see more companies in those, each of those verticals going after this job, how we can make this job better, how we can make this job easier, gain more efficiency, and deal with the labor shortage we have here or here or here. And I think that's a really exciting opportunity, because you can leverage outside models, but you can build enough workflows that you create a moat for yourself and differentiation for yourself. And then you can help solve this talent gap that we have that so many companies are trying to solve, to get the right people to help them do what they need and just drive a lot of efficiency.
No, that makes a ton of sense. And I think another thing that's very top of mind for founders is it the big established companies that owns the systems of records and the workflows that will win, or will the startups find the distribution before those companies find the innovation? Yeah. What are some opportunities that you think that existing players will continue dominating? And what are some areas where you think it makes sense to build a company reimagining a product from an first principles with an AI-first approach?
Yeah, I think that the delivery and development of large LLMs is probably an area where the incumbents have a massive advantage. And I put OpenAI and I put into that bucket. I think they've earned the right to call themselves an incumbent in this space, even though they're a newcomer company. But I think that's harder ground.
Yeah.
And it's harder research and harder development. I think that the areas, not saying that if you can do that and you can achieve that you can build a great business, because you can, but it may just not be the easiest low-hanging fruit for a new founder to go and create a vector.
Yeah.
I think it's really around the infrastructure piece, around how you can build the tooling to make those technologies accessible in some way to enterprises and large enterprises that want to go and try to build their own LLM technology and have their own internal AI programs, or around the application layer piece, around how you can make these things really accessible and relevant, that last mile to these different user groups within businesses and with consumers.
Yeah, that makes a ton of sense. When I was talking to Andrew about that, he described a lot of the sort of first wave of AI startups as, you know, you remember the flashlight app and the early iPhone, or like the beer app and those sorts of things. It's like very, very, you know, you have all of the sudden, you can use the touchscreen and so on, but they're very light experiences and few of them became enduring businesses.
Yeah, and I think that's to my point of earlier, like there was a first mover advantage then, that you came out with that app, you could charge like $2 for it on the Apple Store, you all of a sudden had a nice business, but it wasn't enduring because all of a sudden there were like 50 of those lightweight apps in that category, and then all of a sudden the margins went away.
Yeah.
And so you really have to think about how can you want to be a first mover, but you want to be really nuanced in your approach.
Yeah, that makes sense. If you look at a company that feels like it lives by a lot of the elements of an enduring company, it's Google, and now even they are challenged. And it was this internal memo at Google that was leaked, which is like, there are no moats. You know, open source is killing us. There are no moats for us, and there are no moats for OpenAI either. I know you probably disagree with some of those statements, but I can still imagine, you know, you've had to revise your view of the world a bit after this. What are the key discussions that happen at Sequoia now when you're on your Monday partner meetings, you're evaluating a deal and you're thinking through the sustainable advantages? Were there some things that you thought was moats historically? Like, I remember putting one of these like data network effects slides on my first presentation. I didn't really believe in it, but VCs loved that slide. And we would spend like 20 minutes on this like data network effect slides. Do you think that there are enduring like advantages in, you know, data network effects and other moats, or has that shifted slightly now?
I think that the advantage of scale has become even more important than ever before.
Yeah.
And so that's a tip towards bigger incumbent type companies, because they're going to have access to more data. They're going to have access to more information. They're going to have more resources to process it, to train more powerful models. They're going to have more people to throw against building more powerful models. But I think that the area where for startups, it's really interesting is in having the unique insights around what's important to the customer.
Yeah.
And if you have those unique insights around what's important to the customer, because you're closer to the customer, you're more understanding of the customer experience, then you can build really unique differentiated products and services on top of them, and then create ways that have hooks and experiences and workflows or whatever it may be that are so unique to that user that that user loves you.
Yeah.
And, you know, outside of AI, we talk a lot about like the power of community.
Yeah.
And if you can build a company that has a community,
yeah,
a community of people who love you, who are your champions, who speak for you, who when they change jobs, they want to bring you into the next place that they go.
Yeah.
Or if it's a consumer company, if they love you so much, they want to tell all their friends about you.
Yeah.
That's where you really want to be. And so you want to, that's the advantage that you have as a startup, is understanding your users so well that you create a community for them that they feel emboldened by, and then they are just as big a champions for you as you are for them.
That makes a ton of sense. Maybe you should add community then to your enduring companies.
We should.
Yeah, and credit.
We can't give away all the secrets though.
That's awesome. Okay, so the next discussion now is about the decade ahead. And I feel like I'm running these ideas on very good compute here, and I'd love for you to share your view on the decade ahead, and mostly focus on the optimistic sides. You know, we're standing now, and we could really augment human capabilities as we spoke about here previously, and it's even hard to, you know, predict a few days. Yeah. But I thought, given that this is so good compute, maybe you could sort of run a full 10-year simulation for me.
A full 10-year simulation? Oh, I mean, yeah, if I knew that, then I'd just do it and be on a beach somewhere.
It feels like you could be on a beach, actually.
Yes, thank you.
Sequoia has done pretty well.
Thank you. I think that the world is going to change dramatically a decade from now. And just think about the differences between the world before the mobile phone and today, you know, and how difficult our lives would be and how we have everything so accessible. And I think this is at least, you know, 3 to 4x as impactful for each one of us as the mobile phone, possibly more, in the amount of automation we'll see in our lives, the amount of things that we have to deal with will be reduced, the amount of friction, and we'll just be able to focus ourselves on higher level problems and higher level opportunities.
Yeah.
And I think that's just going to be a really great thing for a lot of people. I think the flip side is we're probably going to have to deal with a little bit of displacement in humanity with people that might be disintermediated by some of these jobs, or may feel like they're taking away opportunity. And how do we help bring everybody up?
Yeah.
and elevate everybody? I think that already has happened to an extent in our world, which causes lots of problems.
Yeah.
But you know, how do we make sure we bring everybody along the journey as the world and life gets better?
Yeah.
Will be an important thing for us to figure out. But I think overall, just we're going to see a lot more automation, a lot less menial work, a lot more higher level thinking, a lot more ability to focus on research, a lot more ability to focus on higher level problems. I think it's just net good for humanity.
That's an awesome note to end this on. Matt, tack så jättemycket för att du kom till Stockholm.
Tack så mycket.
It's really an honor to have you here.
Okay, thank you.